All right. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Google Hangout with athlete Ian Deans, who is going to be competing at the Nakiska Ski Cross event happening this weekend, December the 5th and 6th. My name's Janet. I am hosting on behalf of Nakiska Ski Area and RCR, and I will turn it over to Ian to introduce himself and tell us a little bit about what he's been up to, where he's living right now, and what the sport is exactly, the team he is on, and the sponsors that he has currently.
Hey guys, I'm Ian Deans, Canada Ski Cross athlete, originally from Kelowna, British Columbia, now live in Seattle. I got married, so moved down to Seattle. I race on the Canadian national team. I got picked up by them in 2012 after winning the North America title. And my sponsors, I don't have any major corporate sponsors, but I do have some companies that supply me with goods. 18th and Main, which supply me with like golf and travel attire, and Experience Headphones, which supply me with headphones for when I'm traveling when I'm skiing, because it's a big part of my warm-up and my process when I'm out on the slopes.
Cool. So, Ian, ski cross is fairly new to the sports scene. If you had 20 seconds to describe it to someone who's never heard of it before, what would you say to them?
Oh, you're missing out if you haven't seen it. It's four guys. They go down a course built out of snow, and the first one down to the bottom wins. So it's the classic racing your buddies down the hill and getting to the finish line first. But it's full of obstacles like rollers and big banks and huge jumps. So the adrenaline factor is massive. There's a lot of crashes. There's a lot of action, and it's just a great time. So if you haven't seen it, I definitely advise taking a look.
Cool. So how did you get into skiing? How old were you, and when did you first get on skis?
Started skiing when I was two. We grew up skiing at Big White Ski Resort in Kelowna, and my parents were huge into skiing, so they kind of stuck me in their backpack when I was like one and a half, and then finally put me on the little tiny skis with the little edgy wedgies. They're probably like 30 centimeters long max, and I remember skiing on those and having a blast. So when I started skiing full-time is when I really got a passion for skiing. And then eventually we actually moved up. My whole family moved up to Big White for a winter. And my mom said, do you want to go in the freestyle program or in the racing program? And I said, well, I'm going to go in the racing program because that's what everyone else is doing. I wanted to stay with my friends. So that's when I originally got into racing.
Okay, so, you know, we talk about freestyle. I mean, we see some alpine, you know, ski racing. So how did you get into ski cross?
Well, after I raced alpine for probably 6 or 7 years, I was about 18, like finishing high school, and I wanted to go to college for alpine racing, and I applied to a bunch of schools, and I got in, but I didn't get my points where I needed to be to get a scholarship because I hurt myself. I broke all my skis, and it was a disaster of like a senior year of high school. So I decided to go to university instead and continue my education. And then one of my friends, and when I was in my second year of my degree, he said, come and try a ski cross event, because it was still new and I've heard of it. One of our teammates, Kelsey Sirwa, is from Kelowna, so she was doing it. So I knew what it was about, and I went in and I did well. I got third. And so I was instantly hooked, and I thought, I can do this, and I just tried to do it for fun for a season, and ended up going to nationals, getting third at nationals, and just kind of snowballed from there.
So let me get this straight. You used to ski race, and then you had a horrible year, and it kind of took a backseat to school, and then you woke up one day and took third, and
yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, I was pretty ecstatic. I mean, I didn't really know much about it. I didn't know how to pull a start. I didn't know how to absorb any jumps or rollers or how to draft anybody, but you do it enough and you're good enough at skiing that you just kind of adapt to it. And I guess that's what makes a good ski cross racer, is being able to adapt.
That's awesome. So, you know, when did you join the national team again? How did that happen?
2012. I won the North America title, so once I started doing the races that my friend suggested me to enter. I took it seriously after two seasons of doing it just recreationally while I was doing my degree. And once I won the North America title, that gives you rights to a racing spot on the World Cup Tour. And the national team decided to give me a shot, pick me up, and go through summer training and preseason training. And then I got invited to the full team, to the senior team.
That's amazing. So, you know, talking about all that, there's a lot, but what's been the highlight of your career so far?
It's kind of ironic that you say that. The highlight and the low light of my career is kind of the same time at Telluride in 2012. So the same year I joined the team, I qualified 14th, which was great for me, and qualifying is never easy because there's 60 guys and they're shooting for 32 spots, so you have to be within that, it's usually about 1.5 seconds from first to 32nd spot. So I qualified 14th, and in the second round I was winning and I got in a crash and accident and I blew my knee, but the amount of adrenaline and fun that I was actually having at that race, it overshadowed my injury for the first while anyways. And I had so much, it sounds bad, but I had so much fun blowing my knee because it's so great to be able to compete with the top guys in the world and know that you can step up against them and kind of show them what you're made of. So it was both the highlight of knowing what I'm capable of doing, but also the low light because I ended my season prematurely.
Wow. So what happened with your knee? What was the actual injury?
My ACL was fully ruptured. My LCL, so on the outside of your knee, the lateral ligament. My lateral meniscus as well. And then I had a lot of bone bruising in my femur and the head of my tibia. So it was a big mess. It wasn't pretty.
And so I guess from then you were laid up, and did you go to surgery? What happened after that?
Yeah, so I went to surgery in March, so it was about 2.5 months, and the reason why I wasn't in earlier just because there was so much trauma to that area, and they wanted things to kind of calm down, the swelling to go down, and the range of motion to improve before they operated. And once it finally did, Dr. Herdon Banff is a great surgeon. He went in, fixed it up, and it went smoothly, but it hurt a lot. It was a tough first few weeks for sure.
And I think that if we're into a little bit of show and tell, people can go on your Instagram account and see a couple selfies you took of your knee after surgery.
I actually had two surgeries, so there's a few different pictures, and if you have a strong stomach, I'd advise going and checking it out. But if you have a weak one, maybe not, because it's kind of gruesome.
Okay. So after the surgery, obviously you've got to rebuild your knee, do some physiotherapy. What happened in terms of training? Like, where did you have to start from?
Pretty much ground zero. I mean, from going through surgery, being on crutches for pretty much 4 months, you have to relearn to walk. Your stride, your gait, isn't quite the same, so you have to remember, you have to strike with your heel, roll to your toe, push off, you have to use your calf. It's rebuilding pretty much your whole foundation from walking to running to jumping to heavy squats and dynamic explosive movements. So it's a lot. It's building your foundation from ground zero pretty much.
And it sounds like you're going from, you know, you got into the racing and you were going 100 kilometers an hour, and then all of a sudden you're injured, so you stop. So how did you handle that mentally?
It was tough. I mean, I had a goal to go to Sochi, and then that was what I was shooting for, and I might have been on track had I not have hurt my knee. So you first go through a bunch of denial. You don't really think that it's true, and at first I was like, did I actually just blow my knee? Like, this is a horror story. Every professional skier has nearly done it. Like, it's pretty much like your way of passage to entering professional skiing is you have a blown knee or a reconstructed knee. So it was really tough, but having a support group behind me, both of the team, my parents, my now wife, that's what made it the easiest to get through it, because it is tough. It's extremely hard.
It sounds like it. Yeah. So let's bring us up to speed. As you were rehabilitating your knee and you're getting stronger, what does your training program look like now? What's a typical day in your life at this time?
So we're at Nakiska now, and the race is in 3 days. So like a typical training day here is we'll get up at like 6:30 or so, get some breakfast, go to the hill at 7:30, and we're on snow for 3-4 hours, and it's usually a combination of pulling starts or skiing gates. So we like to switch it up because ski cross isn't just one thing. It's not one motion the whole time. It's extremely dynamic. So having a well-rounded, repertoire. You need to be well-rounded. So all the training that we do is extremely diverse. And then once we're done skiing, we'll come down for lunch, and that's when we start going through the whole repair of our bodies because we take a beating out there. So we'll come back, we'll go see our physiotherapist. He'll work on us, work on our muscles, get us loose, and then if we decide we need it, we can go to see our massage therapist. And then usually after that, we go to the gym and do a little flush workout. We'll spin on the bike for 20, 30 minutes, do some stretching, do some core, and then depending on the schedule for the next day, we might do a lifting workout to maintain all that muscle mass we built in the off season. It's a big day. It's a lot. And then we get dinner at like 7 o'clock and do it all over again the next day.
Wow. So it's like a full-time job, I guess, being an athlete.
24/7. If you have any downtime, you're usually watching video, you're adapting, trying to learn what you can improve. So it is full time.
And I know that at Nakiska we had a massive dumping of snow, which was fabulous for the people that love the powder, but it wasn't so good for the ski cross track because we do need it to be hard packed in order for you guys to race on it. So I understand you were doing a little bit of a different training with your physiotherapists.
How so?
The squash, I think you guys were playing.
Yeah, so we went into Calgary, and there's a new training facility, the Wind Sport, it's called, and it's unlike any gym I've ever been to before, and they let us come in and work out there, and it's an amazing facility. And then after that, we went and got our butt kicked by our physiotherapist and personal trainer, who are a lot better at squash than us, so my glutes and quads were pretty sore, but I had something to prove because my mom used to be the provincial champion of squash back in her 20s, so I had to live up to the name and try and do my best.
And how did you do then?
Not bad. I took a few games on the other athletes, but I got my butt kicked by our physio and by our trainer. So we're all competitive though, so we really push each other, and it's tough to lose. None of us like losing, and that's what makes us good skiers. We always push and always trying to win.
All right, so getting away from, I guess, the technical side of the skiing and what work you put in physically, this summer, I mean, you're preparing to come back to the team. You know, talk a little bit about some of the big life events that you had, and what do you do for dry land training, and how did you prepare to come back to ski Nakiska on, home turf?
Right. Well, I mean, first off, it's awesome to have a race at home. It allows our fans to connect with us because all the other races are in Europe. So for our Canadian and North American fans, it's tough for them to actually connect with us. So to have it here at Nakiska is big, especially having Calgary so close. Everyone can come and watch. But my dry land, my training, it really started with my rehab because I was immobilized with my leg for so long that my muscle actually shrunk, and I had to rebuild and repair that muscle. So it started in January, whereas everybody else started kind of May, like 1st of May. So I have like 4 months of physical training on top of everybody, but I've been pushing it for that much longer, so could be fatigued, I don't know. So it's extremely hard to be pushing it for that long, but with everything that is going on and everything that's at stake at this race, it makes it worth it. So when I had a lot of stuff going on this summer, I moved to another country, I got married, so to keep up with that physical training was tough, but it, like I said, you have to look at goal, you have to look at the first race that I've been working 2 years to get back to. So got to focus on that.
All right, I apologize. I've got a guard dog downstairs that's making sure that no one comes in to interrupt us. So is there anybody that, you know, particularly inspires you or that you kind of sought mentorship from, especially when you were going through that really tough time of, you know, starting from ground zero?
Yeah. I like to start even before that, working with the guys, the older guys on the team. They're all, and they all have been racing for a while, and they're phenomenal skiers. So for me to actually learn from them is huge, and that's the skiing side. But on, like, skiing is one part of my life. I have a whole another side of normal living, just like everybody else, and I draw a lot of inspiration from my grandpa. He's 93. He volunteers at the airport all the time. He used to be in the Navy, and he golfs 3-4 times a week. So we're really close and tight, and he's a great insight on life. So whenever I have an issue or something, I'll talk to him because he always seems to know what's the best for me. So
that's awesome. So you talk about normal life. So I think that, you know, at this point, this is when life starts to get probably less normal. So where do you go after Nakiska? What happens with your schedule then?
Well, we're pretty much gone all winter. This is our season, so we're home for all of summer, and then once the snow flies, we're pretty much gone. So we have the race this weekend in Nakiska, and then we're off to France on the 7th, and then we have back-to-back races in France and two races in Italy, and then we're home for Christmas on the 23rd. So I left from Seattle to here on the 22nd, so I'm gone for a whole month. And then we're back for about 10 days or so, and then we're on the road again for a month and a half, all in Europe. So this is literally our only race in North America. So that's why it's so huge for us. This race is so big for the Canadian team.
That's awesome. So that's a funny question here. Is there any kind of an odd thing or a fun fact that about you that might surprise people, or any different hobbies that you might have that people might think are a little bit different?
Maybe not different, but superstitions are something that I'm not huge on, but I have to admit I do have a few. So like, not like baseball where you tie like one shoe first and the other one, then you scratch one armpit and the other, I don't know, like Rafael Nadal is a perfect example of that if you ever watch him, but I pound my knuckles 4 times in the start gate. I don't know why 4. It just kind of gets me fired up having that physical contact, I guess. And then my other hobbies and stuff that I love to do is I'm a huge golfer. I golf as much as I possibly can. A lot of wake surfing and water sports, and then tennis and pretty much anything under the sun, any sport, because one thing I've learned is that ski cross is so much more than just skiing. So we actually do a lot of training in gymnastics just to get that air presence and that the proprioception of where you are in space and time. So any sport that I can do, any sport that I can play is what I'm going to do to try and improve my ability on the slopes.
And do you have any goals set for this season of what you're hoping to accomplish?
There is World Championships, and I want to qualify for that. So there's a few different ways to do it, but basically you have to be fast. So I have something to prove still, and I've done the due diligence. I've put in my hard work, my time, so I hope it's time to pay off now.
Awesome. So do you have any advice for someone that if they're looking to get into ski cross, what would you say to them?
If you're looking to get into ski cross, you need to go skiing. You need to go to the hill. You need to find a ski cross track, find a mobile run, runs with jumps, a train park, and just have fun hitting jumps, practicing going fast, but just keeping in mind that it's a control. It's a control factor. You're on the edge of disaster, but you need to be in control, and that's what makes you fast. So if I'm Joe Skier and I'm going to the mountain, I'd go with a few of my buddies, find like a little trail somewhere in the trees and race them down it, or find a ski cross track if you can find one. That's great. But there's a few events. There's some smaller races in Quebec, and there's a series in BC and Alberta that's put on. So there's it's open for all ages, all categories, young or old, or it's available. So, yeah.
Awesome. That's great advice. So, Ian, I'm going to let you tell everybody, where can they find out more information on you if they wanted to follow you as you start to travel around the world on the World Cup circuit?
Well, I just made a new webpage. It's iandeans.com, and all my social media is at Ian Deans. You can find me on Twitter, on Instagram. I'm a little more active on Instagram. I like the visual cues and effects, but feel free to follow me on anything. And any questions, throw them my way. I'll try to answer them as much as I can.
Awesome. And I definitely can attest, Ian is very active on Instagram. That's how we met. We were Insta friends right away.
That's right.
Awesome. Okay, so thank you so much, Ian. And if you want to learn more about the Alpine Canada Ski Cross Team, you can go to alpinecanada.org. We are hosting at Nakiska the 2014 Audi FIS Nakiska Ski Cross World Cup, supported by Mackenzie Investments. December the 3rd and 4th, we've got official training. December the 5th and 6th, we've got qualifications. And on the 6th, we've got the finals. We're also so excited to host National Ski Day. It's in partnership with Alpine Canada. We will be selling $10 lift tickets at Nakiska, so you can go skiing all day for $10. All proceeds are going to Alpine Canada to support athletes just like Ian. You can go to alpinecanada.org/National Ski Day to print off your voucher and bring it to the resort to redeem it for your $10 lift ticket. It's supported in partnership with Resorts of the Canadian Rockies. And, of course, we've got Nakiska as a part of that. And our Quebec resort, Stoneham, will be also supporting that. We've also got other partners across Canada, Cypress Mountain in BC, Blue Mountain in Ontario, and Calabogie, which is right near my hometown in Ontario. Remember that Nakiska Ski Area does have a ski cross course that will be open later this season, so anybody that's into border cross or ski cross or wants to try it out can come and try it right at Nakiska. We're the official training center for Alpine Canada, Alpine and Ski Cross teams, and we're only 45 minutes away from Calgary. So visit skinakiska.com or Ski Nakiska on Twitter or Instagram as well. We are on Facebook, so you can find us there. And if you're interested in learning about other of the resorts that are with Resorts of the Canadian Rockies, skircr.com. We've got Fernie Alpine Resort, Kimberley Alpine Resort, Kicking Horse Resort, Mont St. Anne, and Stoneham all across Canada. So thank you very much, everyone, for tuning in to this awesome interview with Ian. We're really excited to see this event go down this weekend. So thanks so much, Ian, for speaking with us today, and best of luck. I look forward to seeing you race this weekend.
Awesome. Thanks for having me.
All right. Have a good one. Bye.
Talk to you later.